We've finally got to a point where we could start the engine for the first time, and I've been through this a number of times with both my own projects and those that we've built for other people. There's a lot of work goes in behind the scenes to get up to the point where you can start the engine for the first time, and I think everyone starts to get a little bit sick and tired of that process. You start to lose a little bit of enthusiasm and a little bit of momentum, but the second you hear the engine run for the first time, it really just rejuvenates everyone and you can get back into pushing to the finish line. So the process of getting the engine up and running requires, first of all, a full systems check. Obviously, as you've seen, we've made a complete new wiring harness, and it's a pretty complex harness, easily the most complex harness I've built in my time. And it's a systems check here to just make sure that every input and output is working properly. What we do here is go through and configure all of the inputs in the MoTeC M150 ECU and ensure that they're all reading correctly. Did actually find a couple of small issues there, nothing too difficult to fix. Probably comes from pinning out the connectors at about 2 o'clock in the morning. Sleep is definitely a friend when you're working on something that is so complex. Anyway, once we got that all sorted out, we could also test the outputs. And here what we do is simply put the MoTeC M1 ECU into a test mode, and we can pulse each of the injector outputs. It's important to make sure that they are, first of all, functioning as expected. And secondly, we want to make sure that, for example, the injectors on cylinder one are in fact located on cylinder one. That can play havoc with problems down the track. Exactly the same situation with our coils. We want to make sure that they're firing and that they are assigned to the correct cylinder. The next step is to set up our ref and sync inputs to the ECU. And what we're doing here is basically giving the ECU information about engine position and engine speed. We've got a 60-2 crank trigger wheel from MazWorks. We've got a single sync input again from MazWorks. It was simply a case of configuring the reluctor pickup for the crank in the software and the Hall effect sensor for the sync again in the software. And a nice feature with the MoTeC M1 ECU, it's not that uncommon these days, is it does feature a built-in scope. So what we can do there is essentially disable fuel and spark, so there's no chance that the engine's going to try and fire. We can crank the engine over and physically make sure that the signals the ECU is getting are correct. With the reluctor or magnetic pickup on the crank in particular, that's really important because we can actually make the engine run with the polarity around the right way, but we're going to end up suffering from timing drift. So important to make sure that that's all dialed in. It was also making sure that the sync input is occurring in the correct place. Essentially, with a missing tooth trigger wheel, the place we don't want it to occur is near that missing tooth. Essentially, anywhere away from that, we're going to be okay, and the ECU can easily define or decide whereabouts in the engine cycle it is. Once we did that, before we tried to start the engine, we also set up our snap-on digital timing light and checked our base ignition timing. So this is just a process of making sure that the numbers we're seeing on the laptop screen actually match what is being delivered to the engine. Now, the problem with doing this is at cranking speed, we're not going to get an absolutely rock solid signal. So it's always a case of doing a rough approximation at cranking speed. And then once we've got to a point where the engine's actually up and running, we can come back, revisit this and be a lot more accurate, because the base timing is absolutely critical for engine reliability. If that's not right, we can end up with the engine getting much more or much less timing than we think from the laptop screen numbers. Now, one thing that did actually catch me out here, and it becomes a bit of a coin toss, a bit of a lottery here as to whether you'll be right or wrong, but when you're setting the timing, you can end up with the timing being correct on either the compression stroke, which is where we want it to be, or alternatively the exhaust stroke, which means that it's simply 360 degrees out. So Murphy's Law here, I got this wrong, and that was literally the only thing that stopped us starting it up straight away. Basically cranked the engine and there was just nothing, no popping, no sign of life. Figured that out pretty quickly because I've been here a number of times before. Simply added 360 degrees to the crip value in the MoTeC, which defines the base timing, and it literally started up straight away. So that was actually pretty promising. And really, in terms of a fresh engine startup, no big issues. Once we had the engine running, we can do some systems checks there, make sure that the alternator's charging, make sure that we've got good oil pressure, and all of those sorts of things which are also checked out. At this point, we don't really want to spend too much time running the engine though. We want to really get the engine loaded up on the dyno so we can start braking in the rings. Nothing worse than letting a freshly built engine run at idle, particularly when it's at operating temperature. We can get into a situation here where we end up with the bores glazing. Once that happens, it's basically going to be impossible for us to get the rings to seal properly. So it's really important to get the engine under a little bit of light load very quickly. Once we're comfortable with everything, we finished off a few last little jobs and we got the car onto the mainline Pro Hub dyno for the run-in. Now, there's a lot of misconception and misunderstanding about the break-in process. I hear a lot of engine builders recommending 1,000 kilometers of gentle running, even 5,000 kilometers of gentle running. The reality is, with modern rings and modern honing techniques, we don't need anything like that. We went through a couple of hours of light load running, moving the engine RPM between about 2 and about 4,000 RPM, and cycling between periods of light load where we bring the engine on to boost, perhaps 1 to 3 psi of boost, and then backing off back into vacuum. And what this does is, when we apply positive boost or load to the engine, the combustion pressure here forces the rings out against the cylinder wall, and this helps them bed in. We do need to be mindful though, because that fresh home pattern is pretty rough, and if we just held the engine under sustained high load and high RPM, we're going to generate a lot of heat. So this is why we keep a control over how long we're loading the engine for, as well as the RPM that we're using. As we go through the break-in process, we gradually add both more RPM and more load while we're still varying that. The break-in process also we completed using a mineral grade oil. Once the break-in's complete, we change both the oil and filter and run a good high quality synthetic oil. With the break-in process out of the way, it's time for the fun part, which is the tuning. Now, actually, a little bit of the tuning process actually gets completed during the break-in, because we get to fill in both the fuel and ignition timing values in the areas that we're accessing. This builds up a bit of a picture of what those maps look like. And both the fuel and ignition maps will have relatively smooth and consistent trends. So we start to extrapolate the numbers from the areas we have tuned out into the areas we haven't tuned. And this means that when we start adding more boost, more RPM, or both, as we move out into those untuned areas, we're already going to be pretty close, because we've extrapolated those general trends, which means that our tuning process is really safe. We're not putting a huge amount of undue stress and strain on the engine, and we don't need to hold it in an untuned area where perhaps it's got too much timing or not enough fuel for an extended period of time while we're dialing that in. The other aspect that makes my life a little bit easier here is that the MoTeC M1 runs a Lambda to CAN unit, giving the ECU air fuel ratio or Lambda data, and it uses a function called quick Lambda. Essentially what this means is that all we need to do is drive into the center of a cell, hold the engine in steady state until the air fuel ratio stabilizes, press the Q key, and that'll take us straight onto our target Lambda. I'm not usually a fan of automatic tuning processes, but this is one that I've found repeatedly works exceptionally well, and it does speed up the tuning process. Once we got into the tuning a little bit further, we quickly found that the Garrett GTX 3076R Gen 2 Turbo was proving to be incredibly laggy, but laggy to the point where we were confident something wasn't quite right. We weren't seeing 10 psi of boost pressure until around about 5,500 to 6,000 RPM. And obviously, as we increased the boost using the wastegate duty cycle through the boost control solenoid, things didn't get any better. Now, given that I've seen this sort of situation before, one of the key thoughts in my mind was that the seat had been left out of the TurboSmart wastegate when it had been installed. And this is easy to do. I've seen this so many times. Particularly, it's easy to do when we've had a lot of people working on the car and these parts have been installed, removed, installed again multiple times. Fortunately, with the location of that wastegate, it was a pretty easy task to pop the gate off and have a look. And sure enough, the wastegate seat was missing. Reinstalled that, got it back onto the dyno, and straight away we had much better boost response, with our boost all in by around about 4,400 RPM. Now, that is still reasonably laggy. However, the benefit we've seen here with the SR20VE cylinder head, or the VVL cylinder head, and the Calford cams we're running, is that it loves to rev. And we're running it out to about 8,800 RPM at the moment, and the power is actually still climbing slightly. Given that we are going to be endurance racing this, I wasn't too keen on pushing the RPM too much further. A 9,000 RPM power band, or upper upper rev limit is certainly going to be sufficient for what we need on the track, and that gives us a fairly wide power band to utilize, particularly when it's coupled with the sequential six-speed gearbox from TTI. The ratios are very short, meaning that when we change gear, we don't really drop too far in the rev range. So the only time we're going to be down around 4,000, maybe 4,500 RPM is when we're coming out of a low-speed hairpin, and at that point, we really don't need any more torque anyway. So we're pretty comfortable that it's going to be workable. But at a later point, we may also try swapping to a smaller AR exhaust housing. At the moment, we're running a 1.01. We might try dropping that to a 0.84 and see what that picks us up in terms of boost response, and alternatively, whether that hampers our top end power. In terms of the power itself, we've talked the whole way through that the GTX turbo that we're running is capable of about 650 horsepower. At this point though, we're mere days away from our first event. We've got a lot of unknowns with the whole package, and we certainly don't need 650 horsepower to go racing. So we've purposely been a little bit cautious with the boost and hence the power levels that we're running. What we did initially was we tuned the engine on pump gas, and this allowed me to set up the knock control. I run it up to 20 psi on pump gas, and it was already making pretty impressive numbers. We then switched over to E85, set up the flex fuel strategy in the MoTeC M1, which was really seamless. And on E85, we've set our boost pressure at multiple levels. We've got a steering wheel switch that the driver can use to adjust that. And essentially the base duty cycle, the base boost pressure, I should say, is 10 psi. That's just the wastegate spring pressure. From there, we step up to 12 to 15, 18, 20 psi, and then we've also got a push to pass button that takes us up to 24 psi. On the base boost pressure at 10 psi, we're making 385 horse at the rear wheels, which coincidentally was around about the same power that we're making on the V8. So we're probably going to be pretty competitive with our lap times, even at that base boost pressure. 10 psi as well, we're not really putting a lot of stress on any component in that engine, so I'm expecting reasonably good reliability if we can run it that low. Essentially, for endurance racing, we want to use the lowest power setting we can in order to get the lap times that we need in order to be class competitive. It remains to be seen where that needs to be. Stepping up to the upper level at the higher point with our push to pass setting, 24 psi, we're 593.5, let's call it 594 horsepower. So just a little bit shy of 600 horsepower at the rear wheels. Now, this is still a pretty conservative tune as well. We're not feeding a lot of timing into it. Even at that point, depending on what sort of conversion factor you want to use for our hub dyno, probably safe to say that we're sitting around about 620 flywheel horsepower, so certainly not too shabby from a little 2-litre engine. Now let's have a look in the cockpit and I'll show you how those boost settings are adjusted. Here we've got our steering wheel, and on the left hand side we've got our traction control setting, and we utilized this last season. On the right hand side we've got what was initially set up as a launch control knob, but we run standing starts in this class, so it wasn't actually used. But if we come up and have a look at the dash here on the bottom line, we can see we've got our traction control settings, which we've just looked at. And on the right hand side, I've now set this up as a boost map. So we've got 0 through to 4, remembering our 0 setting, that is 10 psi. Setting 4, we're on 20 psi. And we've also got this button here, which at the moment is labeled light. So we're going to use this for a headlight flasher, but at the moment we're using it for a push to pass. So let's have a look at the dash again and see how that works. So when we press that, it brings up a little warning to the driver saying party time, so we know it's game on. I've set this up so it latches with the throttle as well, so we only need to press the button once and it will stay engaged until the driver backs off the throttle, which you can see there. Setting up that boost control strategy is actually a little bit tricky in the way we've done this, because there's a bit going on. On the back of the steering wheel, we have an ECU master CAN switch pad, and all of our switches as well as the rotary knobs on the steering wheel are wired up to that CAN switch pad. Now, this allows all of the signals from those switches and knobs to be sent to all of the other electronics in the car via a CAN template, or CAN message I should say. A couple of advantages here. First of all, that CAN switch pad is incredibly small, and that's handy because there's not a lot of real estate on the back of a steering wheel. Also, we only need to run four wires from the car through to the steering wheel, which is 12 volts, ground, can high, and can low, so that simplifies our wiring. And a nice feature when we are using can messages is that this is an industry standard protocol. So it doesn't matter whether you're using a MoTeC, a Haltech, a Link, or an ECU master. As long as you know the can template or messaging template, you can set it up to send and receive to all of these different components. And this way, what we've got is that ECU master can switch pad is sending out all of the messages. It's actually being received into the MoTeC C125 dash. The reason we're doing this is that then I can set up a strategy where we're taking throttle position into account as well, so that the driver doesn't actually need to hold that switch down. From here, the C125 then displays that party time message when the button is pressed, so the driver knows that they're at that high boost setting, and it then sends out an appropriate can signal to the M150 ECU to disable the boost limit and run that higher boost pressure. Functionality like this just gives us a lot of flexibility around the torque management of the engine. And particularly, for example, if we get to the racetrack and it's raining or it starts raining during a race, this will allow us to dial back the power or dial up the power as we see fit in order to be competitive while managing the amount of stress and strain on the engine. So all things considered, I'd say that the tuning was a relatively smooth process and pretty much a huge success, barring our one small issue, which was the missing seat in the wastegate. And keep that one in mind, because you may be surprised how often this happens if you're facing an issue where you just can't get the boost response that you know a turbo should be capable of. That is definitely one place to start looking. From here, we've got a lot of work left to do before we can get to the first round, so I'm going to get back to it.
If you liked that episode, make sure you give us a thumbs up, and if you've got questions on anything we discussed, please ask those in the comments and we'll answer them there. If you haven't already subscribed, make sure you do so. This way you won't miss out on any future episodes.